Nou, vraag aan iemand hoe het gaat. En de meeste mensen reageren dan met een lijst van allemaal dingen die ze nog moeten doen. Ze zeggen druk, het gaat goed. Druk zijn is inmiddels bijna statusverhogend, zou je kunnen zeggen. In het nieuwe boek Nooit meer te druk van Tony Crabb vertelt deze psycholoog hoe we de drukte de baas kunnen worden.
Anybody want to reduce their stress today? Take a moment with me. Would you like to take 30 seconds with me to relax? 30 seconds? You want to stop and take a breath?
Druk, moe, geen tijd. Ja, vanaf het ochtendgloren staan onze sensoren meteen op standje turbo en moet er van alles gedaan worden. Je wordt er spontaan moe van.
Oeh, I've just been so busy.
So busy.
I'm tired.
Busy and tired, it's like my mantra.
I swear, I'm the busiest person I know.
Believe me, I'm busy.
Psycholoog en bestselleracteur Tony Crabb vindt dat alleen sukkels het druk hebben. Volgens hem kunnen we makkelijk een goed gevuld leven hebben zonder dat er meteen andere zaken onder lijden. De zogenaamde busyness, waar tegenwoordig bijna elk mens aan onderdoor lijkt te gaan, is uiteindelijk namelijk killing voor je gezondheid, relaties en geluk.
Hey gentlemen, do you want to stop this for a minute?
In het boek van Crabb, Nooit meer te druk, komt hij met adviezen die we in de praktijk kunnen toepassen om zo een prettige leven te leiden.
What are you doing on Wednesday?
I got a thing.
You available Thursday afternoon?
Busy.
Friday?
I got work, then yoga, then drinks with a friend.
Son of a bitch!
There has to be some day in the foreseeable future where both of us are free!
Tony is niet de zoveelste zweverige zelfhulpgoeroe die pretendeert het beter te weten. Met een vrouw, drie kinderen en een baan waarvoor hij de hele wereld overreist, kan ook hij uit eigen ervaring putten. Want ondanks de gekte van de dag gaat het uiteindelijk maar om één ding.
What's the point of living if you can't share your experiences with someone you care about? You know?
I mean, I'm really busy, man.
Yeah, I'm really busy, too.
I've been saying it quite a lot, but what you say in short is that when you're busy or when you say you're busy, actually you're a loser. So therefore, I'm a loser. Tell me why I'm a loser.
Well, I'm not saying you're a loser necessarily, but just think how good you were if you weren't as busy.
Okay.
The fact is, busyness is an excuse a lot of the time. I come across a lot of people who just give up control. They say, and they'll give a lot of energy toward it, convincing me that they're busy. So they'll tell me that they're seven children, that they're single parent, that they've got six multi-million dollar projects, et cetera, et cetera. And what they hope I'll say at the end is, you know what, it's okay.
Yeah.
You really are busy, you really have no choice. But actually, we do have choice. We have choice over how we live, how we focus, how we pay attention to stuff. And all we do by busy and by proclaiming our busyness is we somehow let ourselves off the hook.
But look at those three, or Irene Wüst here, and even you two guys. He's a Department of State in his Senate. He's a professional sportsman, amateur sportsman, works, television, radio, all people doing lots of things.
Yeah.
So what's the difference between doing lots of things or actually being busy?
Okay. So for me, busy isn't... it's not about how much stuff you do in a funny way. It's about the quality of your attention. So what happens is, the way I describe busy is this sense of racing, running, multitasking, cramming, juggling, that actually has us from the moment we wake up. I mean, how many of us here actually sit with our phone by the bed as an alarm? What happened to alarm clocks? Mm-mm. You know, and yet, so we check our email before we even have our first coffee in the morning.
And then guilty.
Yeah. And then that guilty? Schuldig, ja?
Yeah.
Jullie allemaal? Ja? Oké. Iedereen, ja.
And that just sets the tone. And we just race. And actually, the opposite of busy isn't relaxing on a beach. It's not kind of, you know, chill out time. It's actually being able to bring sustained focused attention onto the problems or the people that really matter to you.
What does that mean, sustained focused attention?
So, take the example of our athlete over here. It's the ability persistently to focus on the training and to do it really well without distraction, without checking your phone halfway through. All of the things that matter in our life, all the things we'll look back on, are actually quite difficult. Actually take a bit of time, whether it's spending time with the kids and really devoting time with them, or whether it's becoming an Olympic athlete. These things take time, but when we split our attention in 1,001 ways, somehow we live a grey life. We don't quite get the juice out of any of it.
So is what you're saying is we got to do less but more focused? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, well, one of the things, I think part of it is just accept we have some choices. And actually part of the job is just not responding reactively to this chaos that we're in, but actually making choices over where we focus our time. And then part of it is being more focused. So one of the things, one of the biggest senses that people have is this sense of exhaustion that comes from being so busy. And actually, if all we do is switch our attention less, so actually allow our attention to settle for longer and for deeper onto the work that we're doing, and then just avoid some of this scuttling backwards and forwards, we'd be much less exhausted and would get, I mean, the research suggests about 40% more done.
Is dat iets wat voor jou zou werken, Tim? Als je dus niet dat zozeer minder doet, maar meer gefocust dingen doet en minder heen en weer switchen tussen allerlei verschillende onderwerpen?
Well, I've been listening and I was thinking, if you want to change this, you got to go back to your roots. But why are we doing this so wrong then, when it comes to you? But
yeah, why
what's
we
the question
it so wrong?
We need to answer then?
Well, actually, the research says that we find the temptation of, you know, you've had that look when you look at your phone, you see 17 messages in your box. The temptation of looking at those is harder to resist than sex
but
and chocolate.
Why is the temptation there? Why do I need that? Why do I need to check my email when I wake up?
Yeah.
It's there.
Yes.
So if it's there, if it's just there, why is it so wrong then?
Well, it's not so wrong. So so we're, through evolution, we're primed to enjoy novelty. I mean, to spot tigers in the bushes or whatever. The difference is, all of a sudden, we've had this whole pile of technology come along that just affects the fundamental way we think, the fundamental way we communicate, and we just haven't quite adapted to it. So is it wrong? No. I mean, it's kind of fun. And, I like a bit of messing around on Facebook and all the rest of it. But the point is, if we really want to focus and think about the problems that are important to us, we would do that better if we don't just split our attention.
You compare us to Siamese fighting fish?
Yeah.
What is that all about?
Well, it was just, I wanted to try and say, look, Siamese fighting fish, will, if you give them enough food, they will eat themselves to death. So we're, for the last, what, since the internet came along, last 15 years, we've had an infinite amount of information available to us.
And we keep on eating.
And we just keep on eating, we keep on consuming. And it doesn't, that consumption doesn't give us a lot back.
So where do you start?
So where do you start?
What's the first step?
Well, first step is to get really clear on what matters. The couple of things. So to-do lists are a terrible idea. I find like a lot of people I work with say, I'm prioritizing because I've got a to-do list. And they kind of use red and green and to try and shift.
Yeah.
But actually, what do you put on your to-do list? The only stuff you put on your to-do list is stuff that you're worried you might forget. So almost by definition,
it's not important.
Forgetting is a really good thing.
That's what I have. I forget a lot.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
But I'm serious. Yeah. I always say, if you can't remember, it can't be important.
But if you forget to do your taxes, then you're just fucked.
Like, yeah.
Absolutely. But, you know,
nobody forgets to do his taxes. I've got an oplossingsvoorstel. Wij werken dan iets anders, maar voor de meeste mensen die gewoon 9 tot 5 werken, heeft Zweden wellicht een oplossing om het minder druk te hebben.
Sweden wants employees to know a hard day's work doesn't have to be 8 hours anymore. Swedish firms and studies confirm 30-hour work weeks lead to better employee morale and more work productivity. Data from 600,000 people was reviewed and indicated those who clocked in 50 hours a week had a 30% greater risk of having a stroke than those who have 30 to 40-hour work weeks. CEO and SEO specialist Maria Brath switched her company to a 6-hour work week 3 years ago. She said, quote, "The reason is we actually care about our employees. We care enough to prioritize their time with family, cooking, or doing something else they love." Toyota's headquarters in Sweden moved to 6-hour workdays 13 years ago and reported higher profits along with happier staff. Despite this data, many people still have long work weeks around the world.
That's the question of Tim. If we know this, why don't we act to it? Why don't we work 6 hours a day instead of 8 or 10 or 14 or 17 hours? It's a bit status as well, isn't it?
Yeah, there's a lot of fear. There's some status. I mean, we do play that, like your first video show, we play the competition game. The year I wrote the book, I was incredibly busy. And I won that busy conversation every single time because I'd describe my week and everyone would say, you win.
Yeah.
And there was a satisfaction to some extent in that. But to some extent, so the six-hour day thing, all the research shows that when people work shorter days, they tend not to do less. They tend to be just as productive. But at the same time, in a funny way, my book isn't about work-life balance. So the idea of work-life balance around working fewer hours in the office, to some extent, doesn't fit with a lot of our generations now. So if you look at millennials, they're not looking for balancing work and then life. They think of it all blending together. So there's a different experiment. So that's a really good experiment. I'm interested in that. But there's another experiment that happened at Microsoft in Schiphol, where they just did away with space and time. They say space and time don't matter anymore. You can work anywhere, and you can, you know, just as long as you deliver on objectives.
No working hours. Just do your job wherever, whenever.
And there was a central hub that people could come to, but kind of it's not about you don't have to show up at a certain time. You just have to. And that, in a funny way, I think is a better way forward than even. I think that's a super experiment, but it's a better way forward because that fits. And they also found increases in productivity and increased employee satisfaction. Mm. So I think it's just about saying, look, we are not productivity machines. Actually, we're humans. And if you look at the Davos Economic Forum, what they say that we'll need, the skills that we'll need by 2020, is we need to be good at critical thinking. We need to be really good at creativity. And we need to be really good at connecting with people. And actually, when you stretch thin, we get more selfish. We stop thinking. And actually, our creativity goes out the window. So I think it's just saying technology is fabulous, but use it in a way to help you do the stuff that we as humans do best.
Thank you so much. Nooit meer te druk, een opgeruimd hoofd in een overvolle wereld van Tony Crabb. Thank you so much.